writerly control issues.
I think, it's just sort of important for me to say to like the writers in the room listening is, I think I had a play done, two plays done 8 years ago, and I know Susi very well, and Summer Shorts has a fantastic reputation, which is why I was willing and I did do it. But ordinarily, if I hadn't heard of Susi Westfall and I hadn't participated before, and you didn't have this reputation that you have, I probably would not have let my play be done without. So I just want the writers to know, and especially if you're drama and skill members, or if you're drama and skill members, is that you always do have the right to be present. And if for some reason you can't be present, then you have every right not to. But you know, you do develop, if you do sort of want your work out there, of course we all want our work out there, then I think you know you should, like everyone here this year, go to the festival and see, oh my gosh, the production values last night, like the acting, the everything, the technical, it was like spectacular and stellar. But if you don't know that, either from word of mouth or from seeing the show yourself, you know, it's really a unrecommended thing. But you guys do have, you know, Susie and I have known each other now for like 10 years and that long.
Yes, we put up, we did Sheri's play, which meant that we had to find or get from Actors Theatre Louisville, we were actually the second production of her play, The Bake-Off, which features a 12-foot Pillsbury Doughboy, and we got it. So we had a lot of trust too,
right?
That we could actually bring something that big to life,
right.
Literally to life on the stage.
Right.
So yeah, there's a lot of interesting relationships up here right now.
Yeah.
So
and I'd like to add in on that if I could, just because from my play was it had a lot of technical elements, as you know, and I wrote it a few years ago, and I always said, well, no one will ever do this play because it's, as you saw, it has all these big things that have to be done with it. And of course now you always, when I write things, they're always like, oh, well, you know, keep it simple, you know, and always trying to think, oh, how can I keep it simple and everything. So it was so exciting for me when John's like, we can do this. We can make this happen.
I had no idea how I want to talk to you about
that. You're a good actor. We got this covered. Wings. We can do wings. Don't worry about it. And you know, when Susi first called, she's like, we're going to do it. And so that was so exciting to me to have a theater that said, it's huge and it has a lot to it, and don't worry, we can do it. And that was very exciting to me because I didn't think the script would ever be done.
Okay, that's good.
I would say for me, I was just really disappointed. No,
it was the acting, right?
Yeah. I just didn't find the comedy at all. But, you know, I guess I was in a different situation because the play has been done, it's been published, and so there are, you know, once you get published in it, there are many productions that happen that you don't have control over, and you just get like a Google alert, and then you like read the review, you know. It's like, wow, what is that moment they're talking about? I don't remember writing that at all. But I am very controlling because I write very specific sort of comic beats, and it was really a great lesson for me in like how, you know, actors and a director, it was great not to be part of it and to see like all that you guys found, you know. I mean, it was really wonderful. I don't know, I just feel like I'm gonna be a different writer, or just not a different writer, but different in the room, a little more open to collaboration. And it really felt like a collaboration, even though I hadn't been present at all. You know, it was like, you know, cause I'm an actor, and then I started writing, there's sort of like, there's a lot of stuff in my plays that sometimes actors won't get, you know, and I'm like, this is a great offer, and you're not picking up on it, you know. And to like have these actors pick up on it and go even further was just really exciting.
I had the unusual circumstance of having my play being done here at the same time that the same play was being done in New York at the EST Festival, and I directed the production in New York, and I directed it because I really wanted to see if I could make it exactly the way I heard it. And because I was working on it in New York, I really was not, I felt relieved to not, and I was a little nervous when I came here, and I thought, gee, you know, what do I want from this? and I also feel that my play can easily tip into something that it can make you laugh, and it needs to make you laugh. And if you get too concerned about the mother dying in the other room, it can become a morbid sort of less good experience. Mm-hmm. But I was delighted to see it, and you did it so differently than I did, and I just felt it was lovely to see. And I did feel just like Matt that I learned from it too, and that I could be a little different in the room also. Although I have to say that I still struggle with how it is to be a playwright in the room with a director. I do have those issues. I'm not quite sure what I'm invited to say, what I'm not invited to say, if my anxiety reads too much, if I get too impatient, and I've been asked to leave the room. So I have those issues.
I want to hear that story. I want to hear this story. Tell me, what'd you do?
I guess I've had a lot of experiences where I've gone someplace that was doing one of my 10-minute plays and usually had some sort of conversations with the director beforehand, but because of the budget of the theater and my own like need to have a job, like I couldn't go there to sit in on rehearsals. And I've had experiences that it's like, oh, wonderful, or I'm in one instance, you know, made the mistake of reading a review beforehand that was just awful. They just hated my play, and I was flying out to Colorado to see it. I'm thinking, what did they do to my play? And I go in, and it was lovely. It was wonderful. I totally enjoyed it. It's completely what I would have done with it had I been directing it myself. But I think there's always an anxiety, like. And sometimes I just have to realize, like, oh, you know, that joke just didn't land for that audience for some reason. If I saw it tomorrow night, it would land. Or maybe I need to rethink it in my own brain. So all those things are constantly going on. But, yeah, anxiety is a big part of it.
Oh, sure. You think you guys were anxious?
Sure. Yeah, why don't you talk about that?
Well, it's your anxiety.
It's funny, because I'm actually very very confident in my art, good or bad. I feel like I put out what I believe is good and what I've done the best that I can do with. And if it works, it works. And if it doesn't, some things just don't work. And you know. But this was an interesting experience because in some cases, I was able to communicate with some of you on things that this process is very fast for us. We put these shows up in 2 weeks of rehearsal. So what winds up happening, unfortunately, I would love to have been on the phone all the time and work through this. But we're putting 11 plays together in 2 weeks, and they get about an hour and a half a day, basically. And so what tends to happen for me is I tend to go have more communication in places where there's something I think needs to be discussed, or we can't figure out how to make work. And generally, if you don't hear from me, it's because I don't need to speak with you. I would love to. It's just that it's working. You know, I mean, in your feeling, it's working. So it's an interesting experience because having all of you come, I deeply respect your work. I spend a year with Susi looking at these plays, and Susie's the first line of defense on these plays. She funnels them through and into a pile, a very large pile, and then I start looking at them. And
oh no, you don't start looking at them until the large pile becomes smaller.
Yeah, sure.
And smaller.
Yeah, sure.
And right. Smaller.
I have a triage pile, yes. But no, it's true. I mean, being perfectly honest, I'd love to say I read every single page, but I don't. I begin to read the plays that Susi tells me to read until I decide that yes, this is a play I want to produce, or no, for whatever reason, I can't produce this play. I have another one just like it, or for whatever reason, it doesn't speak to me, or that kind of thing, and then I stop reading it. That's the truth. But for me, I love all of these plays, and I pick them for specific reasons and in ways to make a program work. So I deeply respect your work and very much care that you feel respected in the work and that what you saw was a good representation of what you put on the page. So I hope that is the case, and if not the case, I'll be happy to talk to you about it another time.
Because I haven't seen it yet.
Yeah.
So here's my funny anecdote that some of you have heard, which is that I only had one conversation with Margaret, who directed my play, mm-hmm. and she was so excited, and I was like, oh, this is really cool. Because I wrote the play, and I gave it to you, and then I never heard from you, so I was like, well, I hope you liked it. And then they were like, no, everything's fine. So much like what you said, like, when you don't hear back, it means things are okay. And she said, you know, I just gotta tell you, I'm getting this weird, like sort of like a little bit of a film noir vibe from it, and like I'd like to kind of explore that. And I was like, that sounds really cool. That's great. And I was like, I mean, I don't really want to go like period with it or anything, but I mean, I like, you know, if you feel a little influence. And she's like, great, thank you so much. I'm so excited. And then we didn't talk again. And then the reviews came out, and it's constantly referred to as the film noir play. And you guys have seen it. I haven't seen it yet. So I'm really like excited to see it because I've long since passed sort of like. It's not like I'm gonna go in there and be like, what is my play? You know what I mean? Like, I'm excited to see what it is, and I feel like your attitude slowly changes from, like the more that you have productions, the more that your attitude changes towards what are they gonna do with it, instead of, oh God, what are they gonna do with it? Like, so you start to become like, I'm excited to see what these people think. And the other thing that I just wanted to say that I think has been great, especially since a couple people reference reviews up here, is that I've read all the reviews. And what's, because I am fascinated by shorts. So I've read all the reviews, and what's great is that like, they're so wildly diverse. Like they're all like positive about the overall experience of the evening, which I think is really cool. But some people are like, this one's the best. And some people are like, this one's the best. Some people are like, this one's the worst. And then someone else is like, nope, that's the best one. Yeah. And it's amazing.
I haven't read any of them.
That's okay.
This is making me boring. Yes, I do care about reviews.
No. It's not about not caring about reviews. It's about understanding that when you are approaching an evening of short theater like this, some things are going to be to some people's palate, some things are going to be to others.
But you always want to be the best. You always want to be the one that everyone loves the most.
Okay.
No matter how successful you are. Way more
successful. No. And I'm also listening. I'm not like, I'm the least.
You are my guru.
Lauren's not in here. I'm not Zen-like or Buddhist in any way. Nan can tell you, I have quite a temper. I don't like when people are like, well, I hated this play because da-da-da. But I do, it was just fun to read the reviews because so there's one that like rated all of them on a snort meter and like,
I was so
it was so, no, but it's amazing. Like, I think it's super fun. That's all. I'm sorry if I'm making everyone uncomfortable.
There's something about an evening of shorts like this that does make it a little competitive. Not even for us, but like there was a couple. We were sitting in the audience. There were these two women behind us, and they were, after each one, they're going, "That was the best." No, that was the best. I didn't get that one at all. You know, I mean, it was just like they were just constantly rating him as it was going on.
You know what I think about reviews is that actually what happens is you just feel relief when you have a good review. You know, it doesn't really change your life much. You just feel a relief. And there's kind of a tension inside when you don't get the picture or you're below the fold or whatever it is that kind of stays with you. You feel misunderstood in some way.
I just tell my students, reviews are like, if they're negative, they're to be ignored. If they're positive, they're going to use for marketing purposes.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
Well, but it's also educational that like everyone doesn't like. That's why it's important. You don't just read like one review. Like if I had just read like the Herald review,
right,
then I would think my play was an abomination, and that you know half the plays were terrible, and the other half were godlike, and that was the deal. But I read all of them because everybody has different opinions, and you have to worry about it because it's in your market, and like you know you use those reviews, or maybe you don't. I love that you started off by saying, like, I do my work and I put it out there, and if I feel good about it, because I was like, yeah, good brother, do it. But, like, I'm not worried.
There's 11.
There's 11.
There's 11. Oh, please. That's hardly anything.
Oh, you mean reviews.
No. Oh, no. There's a handful of reviews.
It's just a handful of reviews. I'm sure I can find
out. Oh, I thought you were
It shouldn't be uncomfortable. It's
I think you mentioned, though, something that's really important. Something I felt is important as a development of me as a theater artist, that you kind of get to this place where, okay, not just like, is it exactly what was in my brain, but sort of finding like, oh, this is the way they did it. It's like, oh, do I agree with that choice or not? And I think many of us are, you know, theater artists beyond just writers, whether it's actors or it's directors, or we've done those different things at one point. And I know where I've taken, you know, somebody else's work, and I have a vision for it. And of course, you want to stay true to the writer's word, but the actors are artists also, and the directors and the scene designers are also artists. So it's sort of respecting that, even if you don't always agree with every single choice. And I think that's part of the fun of it and part of the joy of like, oh, that's what they did. That was really kind of interesting. I don't know if I would have done it, but I like that I saw it done. So.
Well, the other side of all of this is, I mean, almost sometimes the easiest part is picking the plays. But then, but it's that damn Forrest Gump box of chocolates kind of a thing. You know, what is it that we, what is it amongst these plays? What if it comes down to 25 or 30 plays? What is it this year that we want to go for? And truthfully, when we started Summer Shorts in the summer of 1996, nobody was producing in the summer at all. And for us, for City Theater, that became this amazing opportunity to say to the more traditional theaters, which surrounded us, who had regular seasons of October to April or May, oh gosh, now everybody's available for the summer. The actors are available, the directors are available, the designers are available. They're scattered across four counties, and we were going to base ourselves at the University of Miami because that was the best venue available to us that was interesting. It's the Ring Theater, which is the Jerry Herman Ring Theater at the University of Miami. And it was a 300-seat flexible theater. And it's on a university campus, which meant it was non-union, and it was affordable on that level because we had decided to go union right off the bat. Because if we were going to do 18 plays, which is what we chose the first year, and Gail Garrison will tell you there was not a caster on a piece of furniture anywhere. I mean, this was stuff coming and going. The idea of it really, we learned from those mistakes profoundly. But we also learned that nobody was seeing anything like this. I mean, even I was a little skeptical of the genre back then, the John Jory genre that he invented to keep the doors of Louisville, you know, the place coming. And then it was like our community sort of ate it up and said, this is a lot of fun. This is exactly the anti-season kind of thing we want to do for the people who were still in Miami for the summer and hadn't escaped to the Hamptons or North Carolina or Colorado or whatever. And over the course of 18 years, it's been so interesting to watch the community change. Our community has become so sophisticated around what this is that that is how our festival really goes. It is not so much what the marketing of it is as it becomes the word of mouth. And when we used to do Summer Shorts at the Ring Theater with 18 plays, on a Saturday and a Sunday, we might feed 200 people in between, which was dinner theater. And all of the point of that was to bring those people in to sit around tables and eat kind of mediocre food, to have that social conversation about what they had just seen.
Yeah.
And we never have done Summer Shorts consciously thematically. We've never said, oh, this is the monster night, or this is the this night, or this is the that night. Although there was the one year that I really had a lot of other work to do and I didn't have a play in the festival, and I was called in to take a look at it in tech, probably 24 hours before we were really going to get in there. And I watched program A and I watched program B, and Gail Garrison said, so what did you think? And I said, do you realize what you've done? And she said, no, what have we done? I said, well, I have to take responsibility too, because, you know, I picked these plays. And what we've got is the fucking death festival. They're either fucking in A or they're dying in B. She said, we did not. I said, no, really, let's look at it for a minute. And I think we had 12 plays that year. Fucking dead. So really, even this year.
The climactic playoff was about next.
It was the fucking short plays about death, and it was a 10-minute play with 10 short plays about death in 10 minutes. And there was a lot of fucking and death. But even this year, if for you guys who saw it last night, you know what? There's like little things that you start to see, which I want to say that John is so brilliant to have found the fact that there are two restaurant plays in our festival that come upon the line. So what do you want? And that's a critical thing right there. And then at one point I said to him at the read-through, do you realize we have two plays about wings? How are we going to do two plays with wings? How are you going to do that? That's your problem. Goodbye. So that's the thing. If you guys saw, as you were watching it last night, and if some of you want to go and see your play again, let us know. But you start to see these patterns that I don't even know that we knew we were seeing. But there's a lot of relationships this year, a lot of like really interesting relationships. And then John has this cockamamie idea of you know, let's put it in a gallery, and it was beautiful. So,
you should be my publicist.
I will be your publicist.
Is this the first year in that venue?
No, we've been in that venue 7 years. This is their
seventh year.
I had a question about the gallery concept, because I thought it worked really beautifully, and I think that's something for a short play festival. You need to have that, some kind of concept for the transitions and an overarching theme.
I mean, quickly, my strength as a director early on, I founded a company with a good friend of mine named Antonio Amadeo, who directed a couple of pieces for us. And our strength was creating worlds in this little tiny black box theater. And that was the thing, visually. We were all about how pieces moved and how you create a world the audience gets to live in. And we just always hated the idea of trying to transition anything in black or anything. That seemed like nonsense stuff. We were like, let the audience watch a show. Let them watch the whole piece. So I tried to figure out a way to tie all these together. And my thought was that the scenic designer came. I said, I don't want a theater. I said, I don't want a proscenium march. I don't want a theater. Don't build me a theater. Build me an event. Build me an installation, a festival, an event, something. And the scenic designer, Jody Delaventura, brought this model in of, she said, I want to change the color of the whole room. I want to hang white curtain everywhere. And I want to turn that into an art museum. And right from there, Antonio and I sat down and went, done. That's what we're doing. So now let's figure out how to put it through the whole show. And that's kind of the way we work. So that's kind of how we kind of built it. And that's where the idea of the art pieces, there is actually a print on the wall for each one of your pieces. Some of them are tucked around a corner, some of them are everywhere else, but there's one. And then the sound design followed suit immediately afterward. That came the last week. And it just sort of worked out that way. Does anyone have any questions? I'd love to open this up. Yes.
Please,
start us out.
When you are designing, how long does it take you to pick the order in which the plays are going, and what goes into the order?
That's easy. You'll notice that the program is printed incorrectly, and that there's an insert in the program for the correct running order, and that's because we have to turn the running order, we have to turn the program into the center, the Performing Arts Center, like a month ahead of time. And I decided last year that I wasn't going to be beholden to a running order that didn't work, because I had to figure it out before we got into rehearsal. So I put the running order together Tuesday of the week before. That's what we did. We took a week in rehearsal, then we did a designer run, and then I threw out three running orders and put the new one in. And that's kind of the way it works. And that's happened for 2 years. There's a gentleman over here named Mark Swanner Mark has written three pieces for us in the last 2 years, not this year, but the last two. And worked alongside of me directing and putting the show together last year. And Mark has a big background with Second City. And so last year, basically, I sat down with Mark and said, how do you put these kind of shows together? You know, how there's got to be a formula for how pieces go together and how things follow. And basically, I give Mark credit. He taught me how to do it. So if it worked, thank you, Mark. And if it didn't, thank you, Mark. But that's it. That's how we did it. Other questions? There are authors. Anything? Yes.
First of all, I just want to say that your concept, it was genius. Okay. I'm embarrassed to say I thought it was an art gallery. I thought I was explaining that it was a real art gallery, and then you think that's like, whoa! Okay, anyway, it was very good. But I had a question for any of the playwrights, and maybe Susi, but how many times did you submit? And was there a question of developing a relationship with City Shorts, or was anyone chosen like on a first submission basis to have a, do you do that ever? Does it take time before you choose somebody?
No, it's a platter of stuff. We have the contest, which of course brings in a lot of the of what our submissions are, and that's a nice sort of added thing that we did 2 years ago. But the truth of it is that we have plays, like we've been sitting on the student for 3 years. We have been sitting on the
really
student.
Really shouldn't sit on the student.
We have been sitting on the student for 3 years, sort of waiting for the cast that might be best for that play. Other things come in, well, like for example, Sheri's play and Holly's play were two scripts last year that we chose for finalists in our inaugural City Theater National Award Short Play Writing contest. It's really long. But what that contest now allows us to do, all of you who are finalists and have plays we're going to be reading tonight and tomorrow, is it gives John and me sort of a little cushion for the planning for next year to say, oh, well, you know, these are really plays we might want to be able to do. So the other thing is Leslie's play, for example, sort of came in. I think Christopher Drain and Leslie Ayvazian are the most produced playwrights at City Theater in 18 years, yes, yeah, for whatever reason. So, you know, whatever. They're just really good writers, and there are a lot of fun to be around. But with Les, because we've done so many of Leslie's plays, they have a very specific reference to them. They have a very specific language and rhythm. And they're very popular pieces with our audiences. And I think we know how to do her plays. So when an opportunity comes along, with this play, I think he went through three drafts with us. And we knew that she had chosen to direct it when EST picked it up. So it was one of those things you say, you sort of take a little deep breath with and say, okay, we're gonna be simultaneously producing this same play, and it's some, and for her, you know, throwing it up in the universe, it is going to be the play that she directed in within her own vision, and then really, you did, you had to trust us. Coming in and seeing what we what we did. And there was some back and forth around some elements of the entrances and exits that John was talking to Leslie about throughout. Other plays, they just appear and you just know, oh my gosh, that's a play we really want to do, because where else will our community see this play otherwise? That's the truth of it. Now, Steve's play was really interesting because we just called him and said, well, you're going to come in and you're going to do this because Nan said so. And we wanted to do that anyway.
That's about right.
But he said, well, I like to write plays. And we are always looking for plays that have more than two characters.
Yes. Yes.
Hear my words. I mean, plays with six characters, seven characters, maybe even eight. We haven't done eight in a while, but we might. As it is in the Dolphin play, those two characters, and you know, there's the two dolphins and there's the guy.
Who wrote that, by the way?
Rick Park. He's from Boston. Well, then they decided, let's throw this other character out there. Let's put the guy sleeping, right? And it just changes visually what you're experiencing. My play, which it started as a one-minute play in December for a writing program I'm in, John really liked, and he said, well, could you write some more to it, and maybe we put it in the first half of the show, and then they come back in the second part of the show. Well, okay, let's see what happens, and there's a way to do it. And then it went from the couple and the waiter to the other woman, and then there was suddenly another woman. I've never actually had a more successful summer shorts experience as a playwright in 18 years as I have with this play. Mm-hmm. I have to say, I have fun, maybe because I stayed out of the room and out of the way. But that's sort of what happens, is they come in different ways. David's play, well, we had two plays of David's, and then we had one play of David's, so, which doesn't mean
No, just to clarify that for, because they weren't. We had chosen two plays of David's to perform, and I took one of them out, frankly, because we weren't doing a very good job of it. I didn't have the cast for it, and the program was running long, and that's where we were. The program was running long, I had to take a play out, I had made a mistake, and we didn't have the right cast for it, and we're struggling through it. And so I made the decision, which I was sorry about, David, that to take the piece out, because I thought we were not going to serve it well. And that was literally what we did in that case.
Yeah, the play is 12 plays?
Yeah, the play is fantastic. I would love to do it.
Well,
and
now
future,
we know
just
how to
we
cast, how it's supposed to be. And you'll tell us. But David came to us, though, really, again, through Bruce, because of Israel.
Israel,
the person, not the country.
Israel?
If you had all questions.
But that, I mean, some of it is because Israel Horovitz has had a couple of plays done with us, and he sent us a play of yours and said, oh, we write together, and I just saw this play that got done in this festival in New York for Halloween, the Mothra play.
Yeah.
And you should look at it. And I'm like a Mothra junkie, groupie girl from my past. And was like, oh God, yeah, that's a fun way to do it. So the plays, we even have plays that come in very late. And suddenly I'm sitting on John's John's whatever, and say, please look at this play, please look at this play.
Yes. But, I mean, part of the short answer to your question is we are unique, maybe not unique, but fortunate for playwrights. This woman is an incredible advocate for playwrights. Trust me, her and I argue very often. There are times where I say to you, stop, they're not your, like, children. Will you let me make a decision? Because she's an unbelievable advocate for playwrights. So we are an open door policy, really. We look at plays that get sent to us, and we read them as many as we can. Susi reads probably realistically. We didn't get through 900 this year. We probably got through 500 though.
No, we did. We got through 900.
I stand corrected. So, but when Susi gives me plays, honestly, I don't look at the names. I make a point of not looking at the names on the plays. So our plays come from established connections. They come from friends of other friends, people we work with. And over half the plays usually come from people who we have not produced before, who I don't know. My feeling is the audience in some cases cares who the playwrights are. No, I don't mean that in an offensive way in any way. Mostly the audience cares that the pieces are good and that they enjoy themselves. So the first reading, I try not to pay attention to who wrote it, to be perfectly honest with you. So.
And right up here, we had a published play.
Mm-hmm.
So we went to the published material because we like it. John actually called me, Kendra, about your play, and he said, this was a great play you gave me. I can't believe, And I said, what play? Oh, you actually took a stack poem that I gave you and you read it yourself? That's kind of fun. And so the plays sort of circle around our office and into the ether. We have people we really like, and we ask them to read for us who know the work. Maybe they're acted with us, or they've been playwrights with us, or they've directed with us. And so I trust them. I said, can you please read, can you please read 25 plays and then tell us, what you think? And so there's a filter that's constantly going on so that we find the stuff that we like. And in some cases, really, it is, golly, this play is a little bit similar to what that one is for this year, and the casting is going to be like this, so let's hold on this one and see. So,
are there any other questions? Please be more questions. Yes.
Was that the entire company that we saw last night, or were there
six? Yes.
That's it. So there's no elderly women then.
There were not this year. No.
Not this year.
But there could be another year.
Sure.
Yeah, we're going to be
sure.
Reading
sure.
Three plays in the finalists that go into a different age range.
We've had casts that are all across the spectrum. It's just the plays that I was interested in doing this year, that's how they felt. So I have to balance what I can cast in a certain size company. Yes?
I don't know if Steve had brought this up, but he brought it up earlier that his play was set in a film noir, which wasn't written that way. And I was just curious, what made you go that direction? Do you bounce it off of him? Was it due to space? Did you see something that he obviously wrote in there that...
I didn't, to be honest with you. That was the director of the piece named Margaret Ledford. I gave that piece to Margaret. She has a very good eye. She's one of our top directors down here. Mm-hmm. And Margaret read it, and that's what she saw. And I said to her, please talk to Steve and see if he sees that in there. And I assume, I hear we had a small conversation.
Because I can't imagine it any other way.
Well, that's it, right, yeah. And now looking at it, right, I don't see it any other way either anymore. So that's kind of a neat thing.
But can you say how he wrote it?
Well, I haven't seen what a film noir version of it is, but I mean, I just wrote it as people on a city street at night. And I would assume that, I intentionally wrote, like, because we had a fantastic conversation on the phone when you were like, okay, I need something for the entire cast, there's six of them, here's all of their headshots, here's a little information about each of the actors, and I was like, super thanks, and then he was like, here's, what I loved was when you talk through, like, we've got a play that does this, we've got a play that does this, we've got a play that does this, what I'm looking for is something different. And so it was fun, and that's how I decided to write the piece. In my mind, at no point was it film noir.
Yeah.
And so I'm really, because what I think is gonna happen when I see it tonight is that they're gonna talk like they're in a film noir, and I feel like if that happens, my head is gonna just, I'm gonna just be like, boo! Not like angry, just like, because in my mind, it's just people talking on a street, like, very fast.
You didn't tweak it based on what he said.
I did not. I have done nothing to it. So I'm really excited to see what it is.
Is it safe to assume that none of you saw last night what you had originally pictured?
Actually, the first time, this is the first time I saw this vampire done the way I had actually envisioned the vampire in my head.
Okay.
Which was kind of really cool. I was like, it's the first, like, when I wrote it, I pictured that. Sort of the smaller productions have had, you know, guys in biker jackets or, you know, just very pale people. So, and that was actually one of the things we first talked about, and I get, you know, so, but I was like, but I'm open, whatever, because I do like seeing the different interpretations.
Okay. So. Anybody else? Weighing on what they saw last night?
I liked what I saw. I mean, you guys tightened up, which I enjoyed. I'm brand new at all this. I've only seen it once when I directed it myself. And there were elements of when I directed it myself that I really liked, that I would have liked to have seen, that I suggested. They didn't take me up on it, but it's cool. I loved it. And then there's things that you guys did that I would love to incorporate into the play. And I actually kind of had a question about that. On collaboration, and when you see someone else direct it, if you like something that they do, I mean, what is the rules or etiquette?
Take it.
Okay. I thought asked first. Didn't want to, you know,
burning bridges. Saying that on NEA lives, you take
yeah.
it.
Take
live
it.
Camera feed.
You take it. Matt, was your help? I'm sorry. I didn't want to interrupt.
No, I'll answer it later.
Matt was a student. Is that how you wrote it? Him being that nerdy, kind of crazy. I don't know how to deal with it, but I love him.
Yeah, I thought he was fantastic. I mean, that was certainly was a broader interpretation than I've seen before, but I thought it was terrific. Like I said, it's once you've kind of had your production of it, it's just really fun to
mm-hmm.
see, like, oh, what do they do? What do they do with it? And I thought they mined the comedy wonderfully and found so much great new business. I think one of my favorite things was that the folder for his
that was all decorated. Will you take that away then? Do you think?
Well, it's already published, but yeah, I would suggest it if somebody, sure.
Once it's published, is that it then? If you see a version and you like something, can you change that? I don't know if it's published.
Don't tell Amy Marsh I said this, but yes, you can change it.
Okay.
They let me change the ending. They let me change the last two pages of cartoon after 3 years of it being published because I was like, oh God, I know how it ends now. And so I changed the ending, and that was a really good thing, but they had to like then eat all of the existing copies of it and reprint, and it was like a whole, but they did it. They did it because St. French is awesome, but like, don't tell them I said that.
That's a big change. You wouldn't do that for like adding.
No,
nowadays there's so, I mean, there's such a great world of like internet publishing and like play scripts and theater now, and they just sort of like are print on demand kind of publishers. So
and
great.
Sam French is published on demand, so it's easier.
So they don't have like a warehouse of 10,000 books.
Well, they still have the ones that they've already
right,
published
right,
on demand,
right.
But now they're print on demand.
Yeah. So it's very easy for them to just change on the thing
gotcha.
And the next thing a print does.
You know, I had a couple of things that I wrote into the script that was important to me. Like, I am interested when people have their backs to the audience. And so I wrote right into the script. I imagined, and I directed it in New York, that the stove was upstage, and that Ralph is at the stove a lot, and the window is up there. And so for certain sections, Ralph and Ellen are talking out the window with their back to the audience. And I wrote that into the script. I also wrote that she just leans on him without touching him. She just leans there, and I wanted that gesture in it of an intimate but non-touching sort of thing. Those things were important to me, and they weren't there. But I did notice that you wrote it all down front, and you put the window on the fourth wall. And I have to say, it took me a minute, but it was okay with me. And I felt that it did open it up. And so I liked that I had both versions.
Mm-hmm.
Even though I hadn't imagined that one.
Yeah. Do we have time for one more question? Anyone have another? Yeah, Mark.
Yeah. I was wondering, for those of you that have had a production of a play that you were not involved in at all, that, say, wasn't successful, if you saw that and thought, you know, oh, those sons of bitches screwed up my play, or thought, damn it, I was not clear in the script that I gave them what I wanted.
That would be
it's never the writer's
fault. I've had both. There's one, I have a one act that I wrote that there it's like a 15-page play with 11 short scenes. And in my theater brain, I'm like, nobody in their right mind would put blackouts in between each scene. Like, they would just flow because that seems just intuitive to me. And I've had productions where, like, oh, they did a blackout and like a set change and it became like a third, I was like dying when I saw it. And so I went back and I rewrote the play and I purposely wrote there are no blackouts and I made it clear within the dialogue that there are no blackouts and made it clear within the, so that just making it, proofing it so that that wouldn't happen in a feature production.
I think acting wise for me, after you've done a few like even readings and workshops of a play, you know what the pitfalls are, so having a little note at the beginning is very helpful.
But there's
style or tone.
There's sometimes though, like I will own that there are times where I've seen something and been like, oh, that you know, I need to be more clear, or I never in a million years would have thought it would go to that place. But one of the first short plays I ever had produced was in Los Angeles. The first time I ever went to Los Angeles, they flew me out because they were doing two in the evening, and I was like, I get to go to LA, it's like a real thing, I'm going to another city, I'm not in Atlanta, yay. And not Atlanta's great, but to have a play done somewhere else. But there's like these things that you're completely unprepared for as a playwright, which is like when the opening of your scene is a motel door opening, and the people, like, you hear the keys outside, and they're like, and they come in laughing, and the one guy's like, I'm just saying that the key always works for me, and the other guy says, well, you're a genius with a room key, Mikey. And then when you see it in production, the door opens, and one of them says, I'm just better with a room key, douchebag, and the response line is, don't call me a douchebag, douchebag. And you're like, that is just a different play. Like, that's just something. So there are times when things happen, and then that was the best, because it was one of the first talkbacks I ever did. I hadn't seen the play, and afterwards, the very first question that was asked was, is that what you envisioned when you wrote the play? And I lied. I was like, oh, it was different, but I really enjoyed it, because I didn't know what to do. I did not know what to do. And I feel like when those things happen, it's always like, it's crazy. It's crazy.
I think what I
wrote,
that's not allowed,
by the way.
Yeah.
Well, they were just winging it. Do you know what I mean?
Like,
I don't know what they were doing.
I think whatever the intention is initially, things get steamrolled. And steamrolled is a negative term, but I don't think intention, but I think directors cast, they read a script, and you've got whatever you've written in, and then in the process, they stop reading those little things that as a writer you put in trying to protect certain moments or whatever. And sometimes they improve things, they do if they have a better idea, but other times they don't. So I think whether intentionally or not, a lot, those things go out the window, and whether it's sometime in rehearsal, an actor improv something, everybody in the room laughed, And they kind of thought, oh yeah, maybe we should check with the, you know, no one checked with the writer, and now that's in. Or you said something about, I want this person should be in a spotlight here and it should do this because you need this to sell this moment. And then once a designer comes in, and a designer's saying, well, here's my lighting design, and then no one's gonna go back and go, wait, what did it say in the script? Didn't it kind of say that? And they're not gonna be like, well, maybe there is a moment for that. They're in the creative process, and that's just kind of part of it. Like, unless you want to really be kind of like an asshole in your script and be like, don't ever ignore the, you know, like, you know, or this sometimes.
That's what I want to do. But.
Well, the safe thing is, if something's, look, if some, the best advice you'll ever get about, like, making sure things get included is put it in the dialogue. Like, if something is essential to your script, acknowledge something in the dialogue. And then, I mean, the story I gave is a bad example because they changed the dialogue, but normally people don't change the dialogue. So if you put something in there like, oh my god, this crack just appeared in the floor, it kind of has to happen because they say it. Do you know what I mean?
Do you think that there is a fluidity that companies, not here of course, feel that they have with shorter plays than they would a full-length drama? Or full-length
I hope not.
I hope not as well, but I mean, what David was talking about, it, I mean, a shorter play, my sense sometimes is that people think it's sort of the springboard, and they have a little bit more license to riff on it than they would sort of a fully realized 90 or 120 minute play.
I think that this goes on quite a play is a fully realized play, though.
No, I don't mean to denigrate it.
But I think that each word is actually even more important than a one act, because you don't have that time to jump on the board before you dive in the water. You start in the water. So I think that actually you need to be more precise in a one act, that all the words, I think, are more important. So when people do take license with it, it's just frustrating.
But I think that's just kind of a challenge of doing short plays, because if you're in a longer play, like, they get kind of trapped into doing what you intended, but if it's a short play, if they make a wrong choice, they don't see the repercussions of it because it's over so quickly.
I know from working last year, one of the real challenges was that as authors, you know, we write short plays, and then once they have to become part of what is, for the people that are sitting there, one show. Yeah. There's, you know, you want to, like, you need something here, and it's not in this play that you wrote, and you want to put it in, and you can't, because John won't let you.
And on that note, thank you.